Accept challenges. Reject norms. Push boundaries. This is Barrow Neurosurgery Basecamp. Your front seat to the teaching rounds of Michael Lawton and Juan Uribe. Join Barrow residents and renowned guests as they seek to understand the most complex, difficult, intricate cases. This is Inside Access you'll find nowhere else. A journey you'll never forget. Come with us as we climb the trail from base camp to the very pinnacle of neurosurgical excellence.
One of the things that I always wanted to be was the surgeon who was there for the cases that no one else wanted to do. When everything else fails, when other people have tried, and then finally that case comes to you. For decades, Dr. Spetzler was the surgeon of last resort. In some ways, I've inherited that position from him. This is a really interesting case of a young girl who had a vertebral artery aneurysm. It was endovascularly sacrificed and occluded. Her other vertebral artery was sacrificed and occluded when the aneurysm grew back, and she went on to develop a de novo aneurysm that somebody tried to do a bypass for and failed. One of Dr. Spetzler's mottos when I was a resident was to be there when everything else failed, to be that surgeon who was there to clean up or to be there for the patient when everything else or everyone else was unsuccessful. And ultimately she came to us. We were the ones who did the case that nobody else wanted to do. And that's really what this case is about. It's an interesting position to be that person at the end of the line, the person or the place of last resort. It means you get great referrals, it means you get challenging cases, and it also means we can learn a lot from being really tested by these tough cases.
All right, so this is a case from just the other day, maybe 2 weeks ago. Adolescent girl with headaches. She had this aneurysm. This is an aneurysm that basically involves the right V4 segment. You can see it here, kind of a fusiform V4 segment. Treatment is shown on the images over here. You can see they basically coiled that V4 aneurysm and took it down. This de novo aneurysm formed in that intervening time. You can see it here, and you can see that here. When you look at the coil mass here, you can see the coils filling.
So the first time they took the vertebral artery where the aneurysm came out.
So they basically took that whole thing down. So that put all the flow going through the left side, and probably in response, because she was young, developed that. This is all at an outside hospital. They did a left V3 sacrifice to basically flow reverse the basilar posterior circulation flow. And despite that, the aneurysm enlarged. You can see it here. So this is now all filling from the PCOM down.
Here's our BB. Defeat the two picus, that aneurysm continue to grow.
When I left Case Western Reserve, I had started my own teaching rounds, which were limited because I was not the chairman of the program. Teaching rounds, to me, were a two-way street. I have to understand that the person in charge of the teaching round, like I would be, learned just as much as the students that were attending. Because when you have people from medical students to fellows who had already finished training, you had a large range of knowledge, and you'd have the naive question from the medical student that you might raise your eyebrows at, why are you asking the silly questions? But very often there was a kernel of truth and a kernel of, you know what, we never even considered this. And then you go all the way up to fellows who had finished their training elsewhere and who had been instructed in doing things according to the institution that they came from. And naturally, they had different approaches, they had different concerns, they had different indications, and that all came together, allowing us to learn from each other and improving the end product for the benefit of the patients. I loved rounds. I mean, I looked forward to them, because days were very long, very extensive, rounds often drifted farther and farther back in the day because basically we had rounds when we finished in the operating room and we could get together. So at times they were late enough so that there would only be a few people, but we sort of targeted for 4 or 5 o'clock, and at that time the room tended to be full, and it was an absolute pleasure to see these young minds grappling with the problems that were presented and finding solutions that we all agreed upon were the best that we could do for a patient. What was unique about the BNI when I came is that we started in 1983 on the first day that we really began the program. We had rounds in the afternoon. And back then when you had rounds, you had to take hundreds of films that you had to put up so that you could see the sequence of an angiogram or whatever study was being done. That program turned into where I would do 3 days and Dr. Sontag would do 2 days of teaching these afternoon rounds. And they became emblematic of what we were trying to accomplish with the importance of teaching and carrying forward the art of neurosurgery. So I know of no other program in the country that does this on a routine fashion on a daily basis. And I'm absolutely delighted that my follower kept this going and that these teaching rounds are maintained. For me, those rounds, I think, are the most critical component of learning decision-making, because you're looking at films, you're deciding whether the patient should be considered for surgery or not. Once you've considered and you decide on surgery, then you go through all the rest of the steps. How would you position the patient? Where would you make the opening? How would you get there? How are you going to avoid pitfalls? And what sort of complications could occur? And when you consider complications that could occur, then you can plan already strategies to mitigate them. So teaching rounds are critically important in my mind.
Yeah, and this over here was an Ica Pica that kind of came around, and it retrograde filled down the vert stump to there. And then on this side, it went down to the pica here and was filling out. Everybody knows this case. So we'll have to pick on you.
I don't mind in the least. How many years was this between the...
3 or 4.
I think one of the most critical points of that is that aneurysm treatment requires follow-up. And I think so many of the problems of the trials is that the follow-up was very short, when in fact recurrence is now, this is not a recurrence, this is a new growth of an aneurysm. And it's only 3 years, but many don't occur until 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 years, and you just don't see them. And since this is a long life disease, that's the problem. But they are clearly flow problems, and here the problem is that you're getting flow retrograde. I think I would treat this with bypass to the both picas to eliminate the need for flow through the basal artery. That probably would be the easiest solution. Knowing Michael, I think this is going to be a contralateral supra-infratentorial approach in the squatting position. I think I would recirculate from below.
And they tried to do a left occipital to pica and failed. So they lost the occipital artery on the left, and she's got no bypass. So what bypass would you use then?
Well, you really have quite a few options. I mean, you've got the other side still, the occipital, but you've got the external carotid artery that you can swing up. To bring up, it's a little more complex, probably an interposition graft, radial artery is what I would prefer. But I would still revascularize from the bottom up.
So you'd go right occipital artery to right pica?
But I think you ideally you'd really revascularize both of them.
That would be your sole strategy, or would you add something?
I would then look at it. Because if you've got adequate flow from the opposite side, that current that's making that aneurysm enlarge would not be there, and you can actually see involution when you change direction, just like when we occlude just below the supracerebellar, I mean, the SCA with basilar artery aneurysms, and we change the flow dramatically. And then if you need to do it directly, I would do that only if that strategy did not achieve the result we hoped for.
Wow, you're pretty good.
You mentioned an interposition graft. If you were going to go that route, what would be your preferred donor?
Well, you have the external carotid artery, which really comes quite close. And wherever they took the occipital artery, there still has to be an occipital artery stump somewhere that you
can. It's like the left OA stump to a radial artery into one of the picas.
Yeah.
I actually agreed and thought what we would need would be a occipital to pica with a pica. So my intent was to do a double bypass.
If you have a really good occipital artery, yeah, you know that can enlarge. Yeah. Good thinking.
So, but we did an angiogram, that one I showed you the day before, and as it turns out, her muscular collateral from her V3 occlusion recanalized the distal V4 segment and filled the pica from below. So,
we didn't see that, so did we?
We didn't. It's not on the slide, unfortunately. We could pull it up.
But,
So it simplified it. We ended up just needing an occipital pica. Not so pretty because this was a redo, and the far lateral was on one side and we extended it. But in reality, it wasn't so bad. This is the this is our pica here on the right side, so our recipient. A lot of scar tissue, so we had to kind of get these tonsils apart. And this is the pica on the other side here, coming around. So I was actually setting this up for an occipital pica, but in the end, we just did the one. There's a nice view of the coil mass. You can see it in front there. This is the two vessels. They come together nicely in the midline there, so we could have done that. Her occipital artery was small. We did the inside-out harvest, so that means raising the muscle and then pulling the artery down from the inside of the flap, which I think is a lot quicker and nicer to do. And you can see here, nice flow. It's just your standard fish mouth and your standard end aside. Nothing fancy here. I think the trick on this one was we had only enough length to reach this. So I had to actually go back and drill a trough almost through the condyle. So it was a very direct route to get down to that that point. And the other thing, because this was a relatively small pica, so by the time it got down to the pica, this didn't have huge caliber. So that you'll notice it's a very long arteriotomy. Usually my rule of thumb is between 2 and 3x, but here it was probably between 3 and 4x the length. And the idea was just to make it as big as possible because we're not only resupplying pica, but also ica in a retrograde way. So a really nice bypass. You can see good pulsation. You're going to get an overview. This is that trough. We had to make this a straight line over and had to take out all this bone in here to make that direct because they didn't want any tension on that caudal loop pulling on the thing. But you can see nice flow. And it was hard for me to justify the pica in here after that. There's our overview shot. So here, postoperatively, we got a nice revasc of the pica territory all the way up to the ica. So what you're seeing here is flow all the way up, and you can see the flash filling there of the aneurysm. So a really strong bypass. And even though it was on its way to occlusion, what we decided to do was take this down with a flow diverter. So Philippe went in there, and he did a transcirculation retrograde transbasilar and was able to stent essentially through the aneurysm here so that we preserve flow down to that pica, just as a protective thing. We actually didn't need to do that, and my inclination was just to take down that sac, but this was in the end what we opted for. So in the end, you can see the construct here with the flow diverter, the bypass here, and then the retrograde circulation this way.
Yeah, very nice. I think that's really the secret. I, It would have been interesting to see what would have happened without the flow diverter.
Yeah.
But as long as it went well, that certainly makes it even better. Yeah, very nice. Yeah, and it really emphasizes the importance of flow. And it's also is a warning that sacrificing internal carotid arteries in order to treat something as a long-term solution increases the risk to the rest of the circulatory system long-term. We wrote a paper about that when I was at Case Western, when I was trying to prove that carotid artery occlusion for treatment of aneurysms is not so good, because when I got there, that was the treatment. And so I had Roski, who became president of CNS at one point, go back and review all the aneurysms that were treated with carotid artery occlusion, and the results were so bad that we didn't have the heart to publish them. But what it did do is it gave us a cohort of patients that had tolerated their internal carotid artery occlusion and gave us longitudinal evidence and increased risk of stroke, increased risk of aneurysm formation. So, I mean, I always think twice about sacrificing an artery and adding on some sort of circulation to help mitigate that change. I think makes sense. Very, very, very nice.
Yeah, it's interesting that I remember back when I was a resident looking at all that stuff in your practice, and it was interesting to me that it was the kids that would seem to get the de novo aneurysms after sacrifice. And you'd think that kids would have more resilient vessels and would tolerate, but those were the ones time and again that would get those.
Yeah.